I'm Derek Mountfield and you're watching Toffee TV.
Welcome to Toffee TV. I am joined by Nick Mernock.
That's it.
From the fans forum. Ped has gone to see how good Martin Stekelenburg is for Holland. He's probably having a lot of things while he's in Holland. He's not here, so it'll be quieter as we move on. Apparently Ian Snowden should have been here.
Yeah.
I've got a picture of him here in some very tight shorts. But Nick, he's missing in action.
Absolutely. And
Anyway, on to the fans forum. You are the chairperson for the fans forum. Began in 2011.
Yeah.
Tell me a bit about it.
Okay, it's a sort of it's a number of fans who have put themselves up to get involved and hopefully work with the club around a number of issues around fan engagement. Something that I had a look at 2.5 years ago, I think, and sort of had a thought, oh well, it was at the time, I think they got their fingers burnt over the badge issues, and the thing we never speak of, and along with a couple of other bits and pieces.
Of Everton.
Yeah, absolutely, and there was some sort of heat thrown around that, as we all remember, but it's sort of, you looked at it and thought, oh, do I really want to get involved in that? But then you think, well, like a lot of Evertonians, I have that inquisition of wanting to know what's going on and sort of wanting to play a little part in the club as and such. So I put my name forward, got involved, and since then I've just begun to sort of work through with it. After about 88 months was asked to become chair, picked it up, and as such now taking it on, quite a few issues that we've dealt with, I'm quite pleased about, and sort of just trying to continue to raise the profile buzz around it, because I think people have some potential misconceptions around what we do and how we operate, and it's a chance to hopefully put some of them right.
We'll talk about those initiatives. Just absolutely. On the badge, by the way, yeah. We were brilliant with that badge.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah.
So maybe get the badge back. Maybe not the manager, but get the badge.
No, I've loved it. I hated it. We had a good season with it.
We were very good.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I actually thought we were going to win some silverware with that. So the badge would forever be imprinted on our history as look how bad the badge was, but we actually won.
Never
some.
Mind the badge is the trophy. Yeah, exactly, absolutely. Exactly. But it wasn't quite to be.
How's it changed then since you've become chairperson to what it was in its inception?
Well, I think, to be honest with you, and this isn't down to me, I'm not going to sit here.
Did you chance to pick yourself up?
It was, I know, but hopefully a little bit of humility goes a long way, Baz, but it's down to the people around the table, and I think also down to the football club. It's when I picked it up, as I say, it was beginning to know where it wanted to go, but there was issues as we all see all the time, some criticism on sort of social media, Facebook, the ability to interact with the club, and was the forum really meeting those gaps, those needs, if you like. I think people have a lot to say about Everton, which is absolutely fantastic. We all know that. You get the same kind of views and points all the time. I think you've got to address them. So what I needed the forum to become was a little bit more realistic in being able to go get those views, bring them back to the club, and make the club sort of understand sort of the concerns, the validity of those concerns, and look to find some ways that we could deal with them. At the same time, looking to improve that engagement between club and fans. And so doing that, then we've brought a number of people in with different skills, with different viewpoints, representing different areas. And that eclectic mix of fans from different age groups, different views, different, some sit in the lounges, some sit in the ground. I think it covers an awful lot of the bases, and hopefully we're beginning now to make sure that people, if they've got something to say, now know if I contact the forum, I'll get something back, I'll get something moved on it. Might not always be what people want, I'm never going to guarantee it and get people's answers, you know, as some of the issues we can maybe talk about later, but I think it's now that the channel is open, and if people have a view, they can contact either me or any other member of the forum. And we begin to take that forward to, you know, to the club's sort of management, if you like.
Thought Ronnie Goodless could give an answer, but he rivals him.
Sorry, I don't know.
No,
that's good, bad, or ugly, really.
It's a massive thing, isn't it, to be able to have that kind of dialogue with the club, because I know it's a European law now, the fans have got to be represented and everything else, but I just think it's fantastic. Something Everton do well, certainly through the Everton in the community, I think, which is absolutely brilliant.
Yeah.
How difficult is it to you kind of touched on it there, yeah, to try and represent, obviously, 40,000 match-going fans.
Yeah.
I'm going to say 500 million of the Evertonians around the world, because everyone's a blue, surely.
Yeah.
How difficult can that be to try and to get points that, I suppose, are valid? What's valid to take to the table? You know, the coffee's too expensive in the Upper Bullens.
The price of hot dogs.
Exactly, that kind of thing. Yeah. You know, how do you get an agenda, I suppose? How do we go about doing that?
I think really the agenda is constructed by the dialogue we have. It has to be. I mean, there's some key issues that we look to work with the club with around sort of that fan communication interaction, which is seen the introductions of quizzes and fans forum presents evenings. We've had the Joe Royal one and we had Tony Bellew one, which allows fans to come into the club, which I think we all love going to the club for any particular reason, and just beginning to get some viewpoints while we sit around the table meeting people. That's the easier point of view. Then it's around addressing the social media, which is a very strong forum, which can be good, bad and ugly. I won't lie to you, but people are then able to come and go, well, what about this? I've experienced that. And as you say, we meet once a month directly with the club, and we have a number of working groups which looks at events, which looks at communication, which looks at a number of areas. So there's two or three meetings a month takes place as part of the forum, and that gives us an opportunity to go out through social media and through the other channels, through supporters clubs, and go, well, what is it that's affecting you? At the outset it was, where's the Arteta money and why have we bought so and so?
Have you found it?
No, I've still not found it. I have looked. I can honestly say it's when
somewhere.
I finish my time on the forum, I'll go, I tried my best to find it where it was, but I don't know where it is. But, you know, and all joking aside, yeah, we all as fans want to know is that, but that's not within my remit. The finances and all those areas aren't. And once we've had a little joke around that, then it is around, well, what does affect you? And I think you've just hit the nail on the head. It is around affordability. You know, you Evertonians, I'm the same. I've got kids. I know sort of all the friends who want to bring their kids to football. It has to stay affordable. Everton's a community club. It's set itself up that way. So football has to stay affordable. And that's not just the price to tickets. It's around the football kits. So it's interaction with fanatics.
Have you played an active part in? Is this what the forum...
The forum
played any kind of part in? What initiatives have you been able to say, yeah, we were involved in that, rather than just, oh, we'd like to be involved in how much it costs to go to game or how much a kit is?
Yeah.
You know, how much input does the forum have for the
It's
club?
Quite a bit now. I think sort of the weight of the arguments that come forward, and I think to be fair, the responsiveness of the club. I mean, you talked around the forum being something sort of different. I think Everton's commitment, I have to say, and is good. We meet monthly. I know other clubs meet sort of quarterly or token two jet meetings a year. Mm. You can't make changes in that kind of thing, but what we have is the ability to meet monthly and then sort of have that direct contact with Robert Elston and others. So the club are buying into it, and that's enabled us, as you say, to come in and go, well, look, the feedback we get is, you're not pricing tickets right. We had a debate the season before last over the Europa League stuff. We felt that a package deal for those would have been a good idea. I think we could have got more fans committing to it.
Yeah.
Club didn't quite see it that way, which is entirely right. We had a healthy debate. You can judge for yourself, sort of, you know, my personal, but I thought the Kiev game was about 5,000-6,000 fans light. That bit of change of atmosphere might have made all the difference, a third goal and we were through, but hey, we can all look back in hindsight, can't we, and change the world. But what it brought up was you needed to make football affordable on a Thursday night, and that's been the pushes for the League Cup tickets this year. £5 for kids, £10 for concessions, makes the football affordable. It gets people to come out and watch the game. So that was a great move. The club were looking at season ticket prices. We were always looking across the park and the ding-dongs that were going on over there. And the great result was we were able to go, well, we got it right. As a club, as fans, all speaking together, we got the ticket pricing right for the season tickets. And the concessions there were brave, because the club was able to look at not just concessions for senior citizens and for juniors, but we pushed hard around. You look at the communities within Merseyside and young people, they don't, when they get 18, they don't hit big money. They're going to university, they're going on apprenticeships for less than £3 an hour at times. You can't afford a ticket with that. So you needed to look at making sure it stayed affordable for them. And the club were brilliantly responsive to that kind of idea, and that was put into place. So I think we've had some good successes with the ticket pricing, and I hope sort of the feedback we had has been quite good. And then the fanatics was another issue.
I think that just quickly on the ticket, and I think that is, it's so important, especially, you know, you look around this city and, you know, the other lot.
Yeah.
You see kids in the street with kits on and what have you.
Yeah.
However, the, you know, their 2 million year waiting list means that they can't go to the game.
No.
So, you know, it's a chance for us to get, I've got young ones, it's a chance for us to take them the game, you know, at affordable price. And I think for me personally, I think 15-5 was fantastic, certainly.
Yeah.
If the performance wasn't fantastic against Norwich, certainly the ticket price.
It's one thing you can't guarantee with the performance.
But certainly I thought that was that worth the treat, because in the past, there's been games where you've looked and thought, if they'd have just reduced this, we'd have had a full house, you know, or we'd have had a lot of people in. I think that, again, is something that you need to keep. Really, on behalf of the fans, you need to keep pushing that, because we want a full Goodison, because the chances are we get a full Goodison, in my opinion, nine times out of ten, we've got a good chance of winning the game, and that's massive. The fanatics thing, you know, in terms of kit pricing or things like that.
First of all, Baz, it was availability. It was sort of, what cheesed me off was like, you talk about our... across the park, they'd have their kit out in May before the last game of the season, and all the kids were running around in them, and our kids had to wait till it started to go cold at the end of August before they could get a kit, and then it was too cold and you had to put a coat over the top of it.
Yeah.
You know, you want it for your summer holidays, even as grown-ups, we want it, you know, want them for our holidays. That was a key.
You don't wear a kit on holiday, mate, stop it.
At the odd time, you've got to put a shirt on just to cause a bit of kerfuffle in the bars, isn't it? But I know, much to me, Mrs. Distaste, oh, you're not going out like that, are you, Divvy? But
it's because you put the shin pads on as well, that's the problem, flip-flops.
Listen, my son would not let me fit into that well-known social media site, of which we shall not mention. It's younger people keep me on my toes, but
I think again, that's another thing, spot on with the in terms of the child, you know, the kids' kits. You want to see them in the new kits running around when it's warm, don't you?
Absolutely.
It's fantastic, isn't it?
And we did that, and then unfortunately this year we had to hiccup with the change in numbers just after we sold the second kit. But again, to be fair, couple of phone calls into the club, into fanatics, and very quickly they honoured the fact that that was wrong. Barclay changed his number, and nobody missed out. They replaced everybody's kit, and I think that was great. And I think that's building a relationship. It's all we can do, Baz, is take it and build it from where it is. But you know, they are listening. I'm patently aware people doubt the validity of some of this contract, and it's worth for Everton. It is a good deal. I know some people may say differently, but for us, the big key is, well, are they going to be responsive? Well, they've responded to the timings of the kits. They look and they're going to improve that. We had a debate around, I hate this thing that Nike do around the, you can have a stadium shirt for £60 or a complete replica for £90. It just rips people off. And I don't think they're minded to go that way, because they understand the kerfuffle go that way around as well. So it's getting the right way, but then there's still the issues around, did you want some of those t-shirts? I'm not sure some of us would wear them either. So there's around getting that right.
Yeah.
And we're hoping now to be going out to the fans and going, well, what do you want on your t-shirts? Yeah. What would you buy?
Okay.
So hopefully that works a bit.
Can I just ask this? Yeah. You're not going to be able to answer this, and you probably agree with me when it's more to do with football, but it just annoys me that we change our kit every year.
Yeah,
I think really, for me personally, I would like to see us keep our home kit for two seasons, change the away kit after the season.
Yeah.
And so every year, there's a new, even the third kit you can bring out every year, but just alternate it. I think for parents, you know, it is an expensive sport, isn't it? And the kids want the full kit and all that.
Kids demand it. And this is the conversation we've had with fanatics around, well, if, you know, I know it's not Everton,
Premier
League full stop, and
it's not Everton's
problem.
I'm just saying, in general, as a football fan, I used to like it when I was, keep the home kit for 2 years, keep the away kit for 2 years, but alternate it, because I just think, you know, in this day and age when
pricing
and everything, it is difficult times, isn't it?
We were looking at concessions, if I'm honest with you, Baz, around sort of some of those issues, and whether one of the things we suggested is, if you are going to do three kits a year, then maybe the third one, certainly for the kids ones, you can sell it as a package at a more discounted price for the full set, because you know, the kids want the full kit, so you know, we can do something on that basis.
Yeah.
Stuff we can keep throwing out, and stuff that people, you know, as long as people
at the end of the day,
it's a business,
one thing. You know, I seen a video the other week with Colin Harvey about the the Holy Trinity statue, which is a massive thing, I think, for the club.
Yeah.
You know, well overdue.
Yeah.
What a brilliant thing. And I know that you've been heavily involved in that as well, so just want to tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, sure. I mean, it was something for me, and I'm sure you're the same. You go around football grounds and you love the history. I know when I take my son since he was four, and like, you go, well, that's so-and-so, he goes to Sunderland, Bob Stoker, well, what did he do? And you'd explain that kind of thing.
I'm a bit
wonderful,
younger than you.
I'll explain Bob Stoker on the 73 Cup fans.
I know,
But all joking aside, it's those kind of triggers, of course, Arsenal, United, whatever else. And I think the grace, and I think, you know, the Dixie sort of statue, and thankfully the bit of work we did around the gates and the stones around there is those pivotal points around the football ground are tremendous. But you're right, I mean, I am of an age where Kendall Ball and Harvey are my heroes, and you know, not getting too gushing, but the other week was just tremendous for me to sort of see Colin's reaction that close up. It's one of those times where you try and hold yourself together, because you do get a bit sad and want pictures and autographs and things. But for me, the word legend is used, I don't know what you think, far too easily. Everyone's a legend after they've knotted three goals or something. You think, now have a word with yourself. But these guys were, and I think, you know, as much as there's talk around the new ground, and as much as everyone, I can't wait to have a big blue stadium on the waterfront and all those kind of things, there is an
issue. It must be happening, because he said it.
That's fine.
Well, that's not within their remit, I'm sure.
I think I did paraphrase the "I would love." But I know.
Nearly
the exclusive you were looking for. And hopefully one day I can come and we can discuss that. But but you just, like all of us, we hope it's something that's going that way. But
will the statue go with us? That's what I'm going to know.
Yes, the key thing we said was that you have to be movable. Dixie and everything, you know, because people paid a lot of money for those stones and the walls. It's all got to be movable, and we have made sure it is.
There's a lovely little wall at Bramley Dock with the two towers. I think the gates would look great there
It's just, it's endless, isn't it? you could have a whole walkway of stones as you go up to it.
Peter Johnson wanted that. Peter Johnson wanted to have Goodison paved with like stones and stuff.
I think
it was gold or within park hampers or something, but he did have that 21 years ago. We wanted that.
Spam labels or something, wasn't it?
If the brought us a few more players, it would have been all right. I mean, in all seriousness, the statue for me is long overdue. I think it's a fantastic thing. You'd have to tip your hat to history, and then you know, Dixie, you know, greatest centre forward of all time. Don't let anyone tell you any difference. That Messi's all right, but he's not Dixie.
No.
You know, and then obviously the Holy Trinity.
Yeah,
and I personally would love a Neville Southall one as well, for the best goalkeeper ever to walk the earth, as far as I'm concerned. But the Holy Trinity, I mean, what a, just a pity, I suppose, that obviously Howard
wasn't there to see it. I mean, hopefully.
And Bawley, of course, you know, that's another the thing. But Howard's just missed it, which is one of them. But his legacy, of course, will live on with the statue.
Completely. And I think for the families as well, because, you know, we are speaking to sort of Alan Balls and Howard's families as well. And hopefully, when it's all ready, the unveiling, we'll have them involved as well, which would be fantastic. But absolutely, I think you're right. You know, Goodison is such a stadium. These iconic sort of statues and meeting places and whatever, it makes for you know, as long as we stay there, it makes it feel right. But I think, you know, to honour those kind of people, it's, for me, it's probably one of the better parts of this, you know. And I do love doing it, and you know, it's a busman's holiday working for the public sport, isn't it, you know. But it's sort of to be involved and say, well, you know, along with a number of other people, when it comes to fruition, I was part of that. That I agree with you. I think they're the right people. Although saying that, Baz, I think, you know, when we went out to the fans, there was a number of, like you say, you said Neville Southall. Other people put other offers, because we did say, you know, is this the right sort of choice?
And you had Sackwell Ersey on the list. Nias, stop it, mate. Neville Southall. No, listen, we've had some fabulous Dave Hickson's in the bum. We've had some incredible footballers, haven't we? And we should be never ever forgetting the achievements that they done. Just before we get on to the important bit of how, you know, how people can get involved. Just one thing, there's a lot of discussion at the moment around atmospheres in the football stadium. Ours is no different. For a night game under the lights, and we were all excited the other week against Crystal Palace, it wasn't really what we'd hoped.
It warmed and then cooled
and
off.
And cooled very quick. That second half, felt like the moon, you know, at times. And it was scary. The dark side of the moon, it felt like, for a long time in the second half. How this is a, I suppose it's a tough one. How do we, how can we better the atmosphere in Goodison? And is there any kind of conversations around what the club can potentially do, or what fans have come to you with? You know, have you had these discussions on social media? Have people come to you and said, take this to the club, and how about X, Y, or Z? Or
It is something that's beginning to come up. There's a couple of areas on Twitter, which you may have seen, one quite large site that's pushing the singing section, sort of mirroring the potential Crystal Palace model. And the gentleman, I think it's the gentleman that runs it, he just works on a pen name, it's hard to tell sometimes on Twitter, isn't it? But anyway, we've asked them to come into the forum and bring their views, so we can have a little listen that way, see what they think. It's something I think that we will go out, but I want it to be fan-led. I don't think it's something that, as a forum, we would suggest, you know. My personal view is I'm not sure I'd want this sort of European brass band going at the back of the Gladys Street or whatever.
I want to follow Crystal Palace in anything, I'll be honest. No. Even though I have to say the atmosphere that they do have at Selhurst Park is fantastic. As long as we don't start putting... I know we had it for the Gareth Barry thing. really want us to go down that route of having little rattles and Chelsea, go all Chelsea on us.
I think if anything,
unless we just put big mics and turn them, play the atmosphere over the tannoy.
I think it's, you know, you want it generated from the pitch. You've said around sort of the evenings, but you've seen some great reactions. I mean, the Middlesbrough game, when, you know, the sort of irate reaction to their goal lifted the atmosphere.
Are you advocating refereeing, bad refereeing decisions to get our crowd going?
To be honest, if I could, I'd advocate a tasty tackle in the first couple of the minutes, but, you know, referees had stopped that now. You know, you'd be sitting on a yellow card after 2 minutes. But I think those sort of, those catalytic moments are the best way to raise it. But if there are other ways, you know, there's this continued talk of safe standing, which is something that will probably raise its head again, should we move stadiums.
That's come back up again this week, hasn't it? There is some great literature on that now around, you know.
Absolutely.
How important it could be in terms of generating atmosphere. The only problem with that is I remember when Fulham got promoted back up in about 2000 or something, and I bought a ticket. I'll stand behind a goal down at Craven Cottage having stuff for ages. Half an hour in, I was like, I want to sit down. It's not all it's cracked up to be.
I need to sit down. But, you know, I think he gives it a choice, though, doesn't it? Yeah, absolutely. If you have that section.
And, of course, they come with seats anyway. That's how it's allocated each day. But I think you're right. I think that the best type of atmosphere is generated by the players on the pitch. I've said this off camera, and me personally, I want us to have a shot in the opening minute, because I think nothing gets the crowd going like an attempt on goal early on. It makes the fans think the players are up for it. However, when games aren't going the way you need them to, that's when we have to play our part. So
I think so. It's a tough one, isn't it? Fans, you know, we are, and sort of really, well, every club will probably say that, but I do think Evertonians are absolutely different class, particularly away from home. And it's just sometimes, I don't know what you find, but I find we're more laid back away from home than we are at home at times. I think the pressure comes after 20 minutes if it isn't going well, and you get that feeling of from the crowd at the moment of, you know, I'm ready to boo and all those kind of things, and it doesn't feel right to me. Whereas away, I think we're more realistic. You go a goal down at West Brom and it was like, we can get this back, and we did.
We're still tremoring in the corner after a couple of dodgy seasons, I'll be honest. We're all very we're waiting, aren't we, for things to go wrong, as a fan base at home. That obviously needs changing, because your home place should be where your fortress is, and people should come to your ground and think, I don't fancy this today, because these are nutcases. Because Frank Lampard's played everywhere, said the most intimidating place is Goodison Park. You know, John Terry said he hates Goodison, because and we have to get that back, we have to remember that. I think as we go forward and we win more games, I think probably winning is the key thing, really. I think once we do that more often, fans will settle down.
Absolutely.
Before we wrap this first part up, what are you here for? Come on, what's the real reason?
You've spoken
about the fans forum. You spoke about people criticising, it's not all that, and other things, you know. So you're giving people an opportunity to let their actions speak louder than words. So how can you do it?
Come and have a go if you think you're hard enough, element, there isn't it? Yeah, there no, absolutely. It is just to ask people if they are minded or interested or feel they have something to offer. We are now looking to bring some new members onto the forum.
Okay.
Time is running out because the closing date is Friday, 14th. But
that's this Friday, by the way.
That's this Friday, by the way. And it's, but the opportunity is just to go online, evertonfc.com/fansforum. There's a small application form, which don't be put off by. It's just really saying, what are your views? What would you change if you were part of the forum? What do you see as the key issues? Just asking people to give us their old first sort of opening views on what they could do and what they could offer. And we'd love to hear from people. It really is a great opportunity. I think, you know, we joked at the beginning, this tongue in cheek around, well, would you really want to get involved? Yeah, I'd say definitely do it, you know. Yeah. And you know, I had my son going, do you really want to get involved in that, Dad? And all those kind of things. But it is moving in the right direction. The club is committed to it. The club is putting the resources into it to make it work. It can be an awful lot better. You know, this is nowhere near the finished article. It only becomes as strong as the people that engage with us. Okay. But people are beginning to engage with us. I think, you know, we hopefully are now going out and speaking to more people, so that if people have issues, we'll directly speak to them as well. And it's paying dividends with the stuff that we've discussed. But it can do a lot more. So, and it can do a lot more with some new ideas. So really, you know, appreciate the opportunity today to come and push it a little, but yeah, please get involved.
There you go. Have your say. Are you one of those who want to change things at Everton? Do you think your voice isn't heard? Here's your opportunity. Get online at evertonfc.com.
Stoke Fans Forum.
There you go, the man said it. Get on there, fill the application form in.
Yeah.
And, you know, let your actions be louder than your words. You could change the future of Everton Football Club. I've built that up unbelievably.
Fantastic.
Get involved. Big thanks to Nick for coming in and telling us all about the Fans Forum. We'll catch you next time on Toffee TV.